you for the invitation. So this work is a common work with Damun Gudarzi, Ange Martinelli, and Alain Pasleg. And so I will be talking about leakage models in cryptography. So usually in cryptography, we consider crypto systems as black boxes where the adversary can interact with you only in a pre-specified way. So the adversary will give an input, you will give an output, and that's all the adversary is going to have. But unfortunately, in real life, this is not what happens. So what is going to happen in real life is that the adversary is going to have the knowledge of side channels. And side channels, I'm going to be really, it's not really precise, but you can see them as noisy channels where he will have information about your secret that he's trying to learn. And side channels, they have been known for a very long time. And actually, even in the Second World War, people have started to use, for example, acoustic attacks where they can monitor the typing on the typing machine and then deduce which what you are typing on. But in the literature, at least in the cryptographic literature, acoustic attacks have started to be studied much later. But there's not only acoustic attacks, there is also electromagnetic attacks, which have been studied in the literature at least since Wim von Eck. So in this example, you can record the electromagnetic emissions of a smartphone, and then you can deduce the bits of the secret key. So on the computer, you can see the bits of the secret key, which is being used for a computation, and deduce the secret key. Similarly, Kocher in 1996, and then Kocher and his students in 1999, has shown that you can do timing attacks and power analysis attacks. So in power analysis attacks, it's the same as electromagnetic attacks. If you can measure the power consumption of a crypto system, then some operations are going to be more expensive than others. For example, in the case of RSA, squarings are going to be less expensive than multiplying two different values. And so with a power analysis attack, you can keep track of when a squaring is done, when a multiplication is done, and once you have this information, you can recover the secret key. And timing attacks, they are really more dangerous than the others because you don't need to have a physical access to the device to do it. For example, if you're interacting with a server and you send the server some information, and the server takes some time to reply to you, and that this time is actually a function, or a noisy function in this case, because there are lots of computation going on in parallel, that the time he takes to answer is a noisy function of the secret, then if you manage to learn to remove the noise and to invert the function, then you know the secret. And this is exploited by the exploits Meltdown and Spectre, which have been publicized a lot recently. So as you can see, side channel attacks, it encompasses a lot of different kinds of attacks. And so when cryptographers have started to try to formalize all these kind of attacks into a common notion, this has been a bit tricky because you need a model which is generic enough to encompass all of this. But if you're generic, then chances are that you will lose in the efficiency because you will not take advantage of the specifics of each of them. So, but I'll get back to this later. So if you look at what a leakage trace looks like, so here in the example of electromagnetic leakage trace, and I think it's during the computation of ECDSA signature. So we can see that the electromagnetic consumption, it will leak the bits of the private key. So it will be 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, etc. And you can see that this is really not a binary information. It's not going, the information that will be leaked to the adversary is not going to be 0 or 1, but it's going really to be some noisy function of this. And so let us take a look at the different ways we can modelize this information, because it's going to be crucial in the challenges that we have in leakage resilient cryptography. So we are going to consider in the rest of this talk that each node of interest follows a distribution X, and the leakage Y will be a randomized function f of X. And the function can be public because you can do an assumption that based on previous experiments that the function is going to be something. So a concrete modelization of leakage, which is quite popular, is Hamming weight plus Gaussian, introduced by Brioux, Clavier, and Olivier. So in this one modelizes really well the leakage for power consumption. So because what's going to happen is that when you flip a certain number of bits at a certain time, then this is going to cost you the number of bits which have been flipped. So here that corresponds to the Hamming weight of X. X is your secret value. And of course, like I said, many operations will happen in parallel, so there will be noise around this computation, and this noise, you can say that it will be a Gaussian of centered over zero and of parameter sigma. So this one is a very concrete modelization of leakage, and of course it is the most likely to differ when you take a different example. So this one is not really practical to use. So we are going to also use slightly more abstract models, and this little abstraction is called noisy leakage models. So in noisy leakage models, you are going to make an assumption which is more abstract and thus easier to handle. So here, we consider that the leakage Y will bias the expected distribution of X. And so the bias metric, actually, you can choose whatever you want. And cryptographers, they mostly used two metrics. So the first one, I call it EN for Euclidean norm. So EN of X given Y, it will be the expected value of the Euclidean norm of two distributions. The first distribution is X without knowing Y, and the second distribution is X given the knowledge of Y. Another bias metric which is used a lot is a statistical distance. So in cryptography, we always say statistical distance instead of total variation distance, but the definitions are really the same. And so it will be one half of the expected value of the distance L1 between X and X given Y. And so the statistical distance, it's called SD, but yeah, it's a straightforward adaptation of the total variation distance, and the total variation distance that I will call statistical distance for now is used a lot of cryptography because it's got a lot of really nice and useful composition properties, probability preservation properties, etc. So we use it a lot, even though there are plenty of other F divergences that you can use. This one is the de facto standard one used. So the noisy leakage models, they are quite realistic because it's so abstract and so generic that you can really encompass whatever you want in it. But the problem is that it's unwieldy, because when you want to prove that, so you have your circuit, which is a Boolean circuit, and so you know that there will be some noisy leakage model on it, and you want to show that your circuit is still secure. So it's going to be tricky because your circuit is a Boolean arithmetic circuit, and so you can only use like classical computer science tools and logic tools to analyze it. But since if you get a leakage like that, then you need to use probability and statistics and information theory tools, which cryptographers are less feel less at ease with, and so it's more complicated to work with it. And this is actually the reason why the most popular models are probing models. And in probing models, we assume that the adversary may know exactly some nodes of interest. So in the threshold probing models, which is the most used, the adversary can choose exactly T nodes to probe. And in the random probing model, for each node, he will know its exact value with probability epsilon. And with probability 1 minus epsilon, he will not learn anything. And in contrary to the noisy leakage model, this one is idealized but easy to use. So from top to bottom, we've got the more realistic model but hardest to use, and the most idealized model but the easiest to use for doing security proofs. Okay, so as cryptographers, our goal is that we will design secure compilers to protect circuits. And so the most naive compiler you can think of if you want to protect one secret, that you are going to do some secret sharing of this secret. So you have a secret X, and you are going to generate random values X1 until XN. And then you compute X0 equal to X XORed by all the XI. And then you are going to store only all the XI. And then the adversary needs to learn all the XI in order to learn your secret X, which is the XOR of all the XI. So what you want, for example, like the simple compiler that I just said, you want to prove that this compiler is secure in the most realistic model of leakage. But of course, if you're trying to do that directly, it's going to be quite complicated to do. So instead, what people do typically is that they will first prove it in the probing model, then use a reduction between probing models and noisy leakage models, and then reduction to a concrete leakage modelization. And what we want to do is to do this chain of reductions the most efficiently possible. Okay, so this is an overview of the previous works. So it's not an exhaustive overview, of course. But so for concrete leakage, we'll consider the Hamming weight plus Gaussian noise. So noisy leakage models, two of them were proposed, which are the one based on the total variation distance or statistical distance, and the one based on the Euclidean norm. Probing models, three of them were proposed, and a few compilers were proposed. And as you can see, there were a few reductions which were done, but the picture was a bit incomplete. And so what we do in this work is to propose two new leakage models. And we actually show that the two noisy leakage models that we introduced and the two which already existed, they can actually be seen as four different instantiations of one single abstract model. And this unification is done using the pointwise mutual information. So we show equivalences between these models. We also do reduction between these models and probing models. And we also do one direct reduction to prove the security of a secure compiler. So unfortunately, I will not have time to talk about the last part, but only about the part about unifying these leakage models and about unifying noisy leakage models and probing models. So only the first row, the second row, and the third row. Okay. First I will briefly recall what is the pointwise mutual information. So the pointwise mutual information of x and y over small x, small y, is the log of the probability. It's the log of a fraction, and on the numerator, it will be the joint probability that big X equal X, big Y equal Y, and on the denominator, it will be the disjoint probabilities that big X is equal to X and big Y is equal to Y. And so we also define its exponential form, which is exponential of small PMI minus 1, and this is the one we are going to use. And it's a really useful tool in computational linguistics as an association measure. So for example, if two words have more chances of occurring together, then the PMI will be really high. And if they have small chances of appearing together, then it will be really low. And we can see, for example, that the mutual information is the expected value of the PMI. So it appears quite naturally in information theory. So one of the things we did is that we unified the leakage matrix using the PMI. And so we can see that both the Euclidean norm and the statistical distance, they can be expressed very simply as averages of the PMI. And so once we got that, we noticed that so the statistical distance of x given y, it's an average of the PMI. So we thought, okay, what happens if this average we strengthen it? So instead of having two expectations, we have one expectation and one maximum. And what if we have two maximums, so no expected value at all? So it turns out that doing this simple tweak, it yields tighter and often simpler proof than what we previously got. So for example, if you use ARE, we can get better proof for reduction between noisy leakage model and probing models, and for ARE, for proof of type noisy leakage models to secure compilers. And we believe that this stems from the fact that ARE and ARE, they are worst case metrics, and EN and SD, they are average case metrics. First I will briefly say a few properties. I will only talk about the self-reducibility property, which is quite interesting for our purposes. It shows essentially that if a certain function f is delta RE noisy for some distribution x, then for any other distribution over the same support, it will be 2 delta over 1 minus delta RE noisy. So it shows that if it's delta RE noisy for x, it is big O of delta noisy for any x prime. And this is nice because it allows to abstract away the underlying distribution. And it makes things quite simpler because you don't have to always keep track of what your underlying distribution is. And you can just say, OK, let's take the uniform or whichever distribution I want. And then you can use that and still be fine with it. How much time do I have? 5 minutes? Yes. OK, I'm going to be quick then. Then what we also did was linking the first row of the picture I showed you at the beginning to the second row. So we considered the concrete leakage model that I told you about previously, and we show and we compute exactly what are the noisiness metrics for this model. And the key takeaway, it's a huge simplification, but the key takeaway is that for this reduction between the first row and the second row, they are all equivalent, so we don't really need to care about it. Another thing that we did is doing a reduction between the noisy leakage and the random probing. And compared to the state of the art, we got a much better proof in the sense that we gain a factor n, where n is the size of the support of x. We gain a factor n compared to the previous proofs. And a conceptual explanation for this is that simply since we took the max instead of the expected value, then at some point we got to express epsilon equal to 1 minus the minimum of the sum of the minimum of some probabilities. And so if we use the statistical distance, we lose a factor n because we have to say that the sum of n elements is less than n times the max of these elements. And on the other hand, if we use ARE, then you have got no loss because the max is equal to the max, and then we don't lose anything. Other things that I didn't have to talk about, I didn't have the time to talk about, is a direct reduction from noisy leakage models to circuit compilers. But it's in the associated paper. And finally, I just wanted to say a quick few words about cryptography and information theory. So something really interesting about cryptography is that, so we do use a few tools from information theory, but we usually always use the same tools, which is a very restricted set of tools. So for divergences between distributions, the total variation distance is everywhere. Kullback-Leibler divergence, we use it sometimes, but not a lot. The Reni divergence, it's even rarer. It's used mostly in lattice-based cryptography. And other F divergences are extremely rare. And so maybe there is some interesting work to do by using specific F divergences instead of always the three sames. And also, when it comes to measuring the correlation between random variables, mostly the mutual information and Pearson's correlation coefficients are used, in particular in side channel attacks. In this work, we use the pointwise mutual information, and maybe if we, so these tools are for only two variables, and so if we want multivariate metrics, what happens? So maybe we can use the multivariate PMI by Van de Kruis, or the total correlation by, I think it's Watanabe, and interaction information by McGill, and what about Reni mutual information, such as the one defined by Sipson, Arimoto, or Sizer? Does it give better results than what we have actually? Well, that are interesting topics, I think. And I think that's all, so thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.